Hello and welcome to this video lecture on Chapter 8, Quality Planning. So let's get started. Our agenda for today is really one point in our agenda. What are the quality standards for the project? So that's what we're trying to do during the planning phase with regard to quality, is to determine what are the standards for the project. So again, a look at our project life cycle. We are continuing in the planning phase, and so this time we're looking at the issue of quality. And if you'll remember, the last time we spoke about quality specifically was during Chapter 1 when we talked about the project constraints. Remember, quality is one of the six project constraints that we discussed in Chapter 1. So it's a key aspect of the project, so we need to think about it. And that's really our topic for today. So an introduction to quality. There are many definitions of quality. There's been a number of writers and thinkers about quality, and there is really all kinds of ways of looking at quality. We use quality, the word quality, all the time in our everyday language. We, you know, a particular phone is quality or not quality. A car is high quality or not quality. So we talk about it, you know, as if we know what it is, and we do know what it is. It is in the eye of the beholder in a big way, but the key thing is to, if we're going to plan for it specifically in a project, is to be able to know what it is and for the purposes of our planning. This course uses a specific definition from J.M. Uran and J.A. Defoe, which is as follows. To be fit for purpose, every good and service must have two things. One is the right features to satisfy the customer needs, and must be delivered with few failures. So that's, it's really a two-pronged approach, which is the right features and few failures. And so now a couple of things on that, just a couple of notes. The right features, well, that's where quality is linked strongly to scope. And in some textbooks and writers and so on really put those together. They don't even disassociate them. They're linked, like completely linked. And this is why, is that part of quality is it doing the things that the customer wants? And if you think about your phone, or think about a vehicle, a car, and so on, if you think about it, yeah, if it doesn't have the features you want, you'd probably not call it a quality phone or car. So that makes sense. And then the second part, is that it is delivered. It has very few failures. And notice the word few. It doesn't say zero, because that's a really tough thing to create, to do. You know, again, think of something you may have what you consider to be a high quality phone. Does that mean it's never failed? That not even once? So this is where this is what really, if we start to get into planning for quality, is we start to think about, well, what is the level? What are the standards that we need to meet in order to be considered quality? So our discussion during this video lecture will be on the second half of this definition, delivered with few failures. That's where we're going to focus, because again, remember the right features, we covered that off during our scope planning. Another writer and key project pioneer was W. Edward Deming, and he was very influential in the quality movement and so on. He's a really, if you're interested in quality, really look and read some of the things that Deming wrote. He emphasized the importance of improvement of processes rather than over-reliance on quality inspection. And that's a key topic within quality is in order to deliver with few failures, there's really kind of two ways you can do it. One is to improve the processes of creation of that. So improve how you create that end result. The other is to check what's coming out on the back end, is to inspect the output. And Deming didn't say we shouldn't inspect the output. He didn't say that, but he emphasized that we should be putting our focus and we should be really focusing and improving the processes. And then you almost get to the point where everything that you create is high quality, and you practically don't need to inspect it, even though you still would to some degree. So anyway, so that's a key concept, and the one that we're going to see throughout this discussion. Quality consists of the following three categories: quality planning, quality assurance, and quality control. This chapter focuses on the first category. So it's quality planning that we're going to be looking at it. Assurance and control will be discussed later in the course. So you will see in a later chapter, in a later lesson, you will see quality assurance and control pop up again. So let's focus on the planning phase. So during planning, the key question, what are the quality standards for the project? Sorry, I went a little too fast there. And that's the creation of the quality management plan. That's the key output of this part of planning. So what are the quality standards of the project? So in order to achieve quality for the project, right features, right few failures, it is important to determine what is expected of the project's product, services, or results. So we need to look at expectations of what's to be produced. And it's very important. It's fundamental to quality thinking is to look at what the customer will be viewing. Is that, quality is what is perceived by those that are using or purchasing it. So that's a key thing. This involves determining the quality standards that the project needs to meet. And again, standards are something that we use in our everyday language and so on. We might say, well, I have certain standards of a restaurant that I would like to go to. There's even rating systems that are standards. This is a 5-star restaurant or a 4-star restaurant, and those are specific ratings that help people understand the standards of the restaurant. You may also, on an everyday basis, you may have standards in terms of timeliness, that your standard is that you were on time for meetings and commitments and so on. That's your standard, is one of timeliness. Now, going hand in hand with standards is the concept of metrics, which allow for more objective measurement of quality standards. And let's just look at that standard of being on time. That's a good standard and one that I recommend. But how do you measure timeliness? does it mean being on time? Well, what does that mean? See, it's subjective. The language is not precise enough. We need a metric to help us determine whether we meet the standard. For example, if you were 2 seconds late for an appointment, like literally your appointment was at 9 a.m. and you were there at 9 a.m. and 2 seconds, have you achieved the standard? Well, if we take a very precise definition, no, you missed. You're late 2 seconds. Well, that's most reasonable people would say, well, no, that's fine. You were there on time. 2 seconds is not reasonable. Like, that's not material. Well, then the question becomes, well, what is the amount of time? What is the metric that we can use? If you're 10 seconds after, if you're 30 seconds, if you're 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. So metrics allows you to determine what is meant by the standard. So the more you use metrics, which are numbers, basically, it allows for more objective measurement of the quality standards. The tolerance, there's a related concept of tolerance, which is, well, if your standard is to be on time, and let's say you had a metric of saying, okay, we're going to say either, how long after the meeting or the time is allowed. Let's say we will have within 1 minute. Let's say we have our standard is to be on time, but we will allow up to 1 minute to still be considered on time. That's called a tolerance. That we will have a tolerance of 1 minute, the metric of 1 minute, to still be considered as meeting that standard. And that's important. Now you might, I'm not saying it should be 1 minute. You might say, no, we have a zero tolerance. If you're a second late, you have missed. For example, if you're running in the Olympic Games and the start of the 100 meter race, you know, is 10 o'clock, if you are 2 seconds late, you missed the, you failed the race. Like you have to be there, you know, 30 minutes before the start. That's where the tolerance is. So really, that's where the standards are important to the project. And also the use of metrics. At this point, please pause the video and go to the case study, creating the quality management plan. So pause and read that. Come on back when you're done. Okay, so you've now read that, the case study update, creating the quality management plan. So when considering the quality management plan, Sophie, the project manager, considers the product to be produced by her project. Now, she's looking at the standards that she needs to develop as part of this of her project. And what's useful at this point is to group them into different categories. There's different types of standards that sort of relate to each other. For example, the DecoCam product launch will have technical standards and so on. There's lots of technology that's being used. So there's technical standards. There's lots of writing. There's lots of website updates and promotional video and all this. There's all kinds of writing standards. So she's creates that as a subtitle or category. There's social media standards. That's a big part of the product launch. And there's communication standards that are, the communication is happening on the project team. So those are four different categories she came up with. Those are not the only categories. Different projects may have different ways, but it's just a way of grouping the different standards so that in the quality management plan, it makes sense. Now, some of the standards could be the same as previous projects. So this does not always need to be completely invented, you know, from first principles. Oftentimes, technical standards are defined by the organization and that you just inherit them. You'll do what the organization says. For example, you know, if we think of Conestoga for a moment, the use of the D2L is a technical standard that's used within this course. So that's something that is true. So then she creates standards for each category, again, either by using the organizational standard or through thinking of what is needed for her own project, if it is unique. And here's the quality management plan that was created. And you can see that there's different standards under each one. For example, under technical standards, all image files will be in the company standard file format. So in this case, we're not going to say what it is. We're just going to say use the company standard in terms of the file format and minimum resolution. So under technical standards, there's we use the company. Notice that all images displayed will be verified to ensure there's no copyright infringement. So we're not going to use images that we will get someone complaining about. We will use ones that do not have copyright infringement. So zero tolerance there. Notice we don't have a metric of we'll use like one or two. It's zero in that case. Now, under writing standards, for example, let's look at standard number 5, the press release. This is a document that's created and sent to the media. We're saying that it will be one of our standards, that it will be 250 words. So you notice there's a metric. We're not saying it's a medium length or, you know, we're saying 250 words. However, you know, if it's 245 or it's 262, that's within our tolerance of plus or minus 50 words. So we have metrics being used and a tolerance. So that's key. Now here's an example. Number 6, all written material will be viewed by anyone outside the company, so our customers and external stakeholders, will contain zero spelling errors or grammatical errors. So there's a case where we have a metric of zero. So if we have one, so in other words, if we have one spelling error in our materials that are going outside the organization, that is a failure of quality. So that's a really strict standard, but it's one that we're very serious about. Look under communication standards, all emails must be responded to within 24 hours. Now notice this isn't something that the customer sees. This is an internal standards. Standards can be things that the customer sees in the product, or it might be how we work together. So there's a emails must be responded to. Instead of saying timely, which who knows what that means, we're saying within 24 hours. That's a metric. Meeting agendas for all formal project meetings are required, not just in advance, 24 hours in advance, because we can measure that and understand what it means. So the creation of a quality management plan lays out the standards that are, wherever possible, metrics and tolerances are included, so that everybody involved understands what quality means to this project. Those are the references for this video. And again, that's the end of the video. And thanks for watching.